Well, welcome everyone. I'm just gonna briefly introduce Washington State TV Echo. I know many of you, if not most of you, are regular participants with TV Echo. But for those of you who have just joined us for the first time for World TV Day, we do have a weekly meeting that's called Echo, that's designed to disseminate best practices, answer clinical questions around TB and LTBI, and just generally share information and helpful tips across across the spectrum of interested parties. If you'd like to, so it's a multi-point video conferencing system which existed before the pandemic. So we were ahead of the curve on that. Typically, this hour-long session involves cases that you bring to us that we can help with the management of, as well as learn from. And every other session, we try to have a didactic. So this provides benefits for both county health departments as well as primary care providers, infectious disease specialists, pulmonologists, all are welcome. We, as I said, didactics and case reviews are this typical format for our sessions, so although we at times have special formats with guest speakers. This involves mentoring from TB specialists until you yourself are part of our TB specialist group. And CME and CNE credits are available during didactic sessions. So again, it's Mondays from 12:30 to 1:30. Please stop by and join us. On average, we have 54 participants, and it's spread across both local health jurisdictions, nurses, as well as healthcare providers in their own practice. And this shows some of the counties in Washington State that we reached. We also reach have participants from around the United States and even internationally, including Canada and Kenya in the past. So here's where you can go if you'd like more information on this. So on this day, World TB Day, where do we stand in terms of incidence of TB in both the United States and the world? And obviously the impacts of the pandemic have affected everything, including TB. I would say that we don't fully understand what those long-term impacts will be at this point. So this is from the MMWR put out by the CDC that shows US TB incidence over a 10-year period. In fact, over a 20-year period, the incidence of TB in the United States decreased steadily. However, this decline slowed over the later years of that period until 2020, when a substantial decline was observed of about 20%. Now, this sharp decrease may have been due to multiple factors related to the pandemic, including delayed or missed TB diagnoses, or a true reduction in TB incidence due to pandemic-related changes in migration patterns, as well as travel. In 2021, a total of 7,860 TB cases were reported to CDC, which is a 9% rise compared to 2020. This rise in incidence occurred amongst both US and non-US born. So you can see this, here's the case counts and here's incidence here. Does this represent a real, is this a real account of how much TB there is in the country? We don't know yet, but the substantial reduction from 2019 would suggest that we're still missing cases of TB out in the community. Now on a global basis, we saw some similar patterns as well. Basically, the pandemic has reversed years of progress in providing essential TB services and reducing TB case rates globally. The most obvious impact was a large drop in the number of reported cases. So this is shown here from 7.1 million in 2019 to 5.8 million in 2020, which is an 18% decline back to the level of 2012. Is this real? We don't know, but on the other hand, and concerningly, the deaths related to TB increased in 2020 compared to 2019. In fact, it went up by 100,000 amongst those who are HIV negative and by 200,000 amongst people living with HIV. So those combined totals bring us back to the level of 2017. Other COVID-related impacts that I did not display here include a reduction between 2019 and 2020 in the number of people provided with treatment for drug-resistant TB, which is down by 15%. and a decline in the number of people who received TB preventive therapy, otherwise known as treatment of LTBI, which was down 20% compared to pre-pandemic levels, as well as a fall in global spending on TB diagnostic treatment and prevention services. So there has been good news, but there have also been some setbacks related to the pandemic. And it's essential that we, as a global community, continue to keep TB at the forefront. And I think World TB Day is an opportunity to keep TB on the front burner for all peoples. So I'll turn it over back to you, Lana.
Thank you, Dave. Thank you for screen share. Thanks. So I just want to give a quick thank you to We Are TB. So We Are TB offers comprehensive peer support for current TB patients and TB clinics. We Are TB is a growing survivor network that's fighting to achieve change in TB diagnostics, treatment regimens, and funding to support US-based public health programs. And this group specializes in connecting medical professionals and current TB patients to TB survivors. And it's also how we had the privilege of meeting Jocelyn and bringing her on today. So just wanted to give a special thank you to We Are TB. They also have a great brochure that was included in your invitation to offer to TB patients and TB survivors. And I also wanted to give a quick shout out to that every Monday, 8 p.m. Eastern time, so that's 5 p.m. Pacific time, they have a Zoom meeting for anybody who wants to join and get started. So be sure to mention that to anybody that you think would be interested. All right, so I have the honor today to introduce Jocelyn Ramos Gonzales, who uses she, they pronouns. Jocelyn is a survivor advocate for We Are TB, she's also a member of the Curry International TB Center's Western Regional Advisory Committee, and also a first year medical student here locally at the University of Washington School of Medicine. She and her family underwent treatment for TB in 2015, and her father's story continues to be a primary motivator for her pursuit of medical education and TB advocacy. Her story exemplifies living life from values of courageousness and perseverance. And before we hear from our TB survivor advocate, we will have a review of the current Washington State TB trends. So we got a little global look from Dr. Horn just then. We're going to really narrow it into national and Washington State TB trends, presented by Kelsey Hewson, an epidemiologist for the tuberculosis program at the Washington State Department of Health. Kelsey joined our program January 2021 after graduating from the University of Washington with a master's in public health. Kelsey is a returning presenter for World TB Day, TB Echo, and it's great to welcome her back for a second year. Thank you both for joining us today. Kelsey, go ahead and get us started. I'm gonna stop the share.
All right, can you all see my screen?
Yes.
Great. All right, so hello everyone. My name is Kelsey, and as Lynn said, I'm an epidemiologist with the TB program at the Washington State Department of Health. And I'm going to be going over a brief overview of tuberculosis epidemiology in Washington State. And to be aware of everyone's time today, we do ask that questions on the information presented wait for the end of all presentations or be discussed offline. And just a quick disclosure, neither I nor my spouse or partner have or had any financial or other relationships with any commercial interest organization within the past 12 months. And our objective for this presentation is to use state TB epidemiology data to identify populations at risk for LTBI and TB disease and improve timely diagnosis. Some key points for this presentation. On average, 4 cases of TB disease are diagnosed in Washington each week. TB disease occurs in most areas of Washington and is more concentrated in urban areas. TB disproportionately affects vulnerable populations in Washington. And the past few years have brought many new challenges, and it's important that we consider COVID-19 for context when looking at this TB data. This graph displays reported tuberculosis disease cases for the past 29 years in Washington state. And over the last 10 years, Washington has seen between 163 and 233 reported cases of tuberculosis disease per year. In 2021, there were 199 cases of TB counted in Washington state. And you can see an increase from the previous year in 2020 with 163 cases of TB counted. And it's possible that the COVID-19 pandemic could have influenced these numbers. As Dr. Horn was mentioning, some people may have been misdiagnosed or delayed seeking medical care, or also more distancing due to COVID-19. However, there are many factors at play, and it would be difficult to draw any real conclusion from the effect of COVID-19 on case identification at this time. And since 1993, incidence rates of TB in Washington, shown here in the solid blue line, have progressed downward overall, similar to the trend seen in the United States as a whole, represented by the red dashed line. And in 2021, the TB case rate in Washington was 2.6 cases per 100,000 persons, and the US case rate for 2021 was 2.4 cases per 100,000 persons. There was an increase in TB case rates from 2020 to 2021, seen in both Washington state and nationally. And although these trends overall represent progress in testing for and treating TB, the current pace of decline remains slow and likely insufficient to achieve TB elimination in this century. This display is similar data to the previous slide, but just shows a zoomed-in timeline for the past 10 years. The blue line still represents Washington TB cases per 100,000 persons, and the bottom section shows the percent change in case rate from the year before. So looking at the bottom section, you can see there's always some fluctuation in the case rate. And however, the drop from the case rate from 2019 to 2020 is outside of what we normally see, with a 28% drop in the case rate to 2.1 cases per 100,000 persons. And COVID-19, again, likely influenced this large drop, but it is too soon to tell the full impact on tuberculosis in Washington state. And then in 2021, the case rate rose to where we might have expected based on previous years, with 2.6 cases per 100,000 persons. And this map illustrates average TB case counts over a 5-year period in Washington counties. Counties in dark blue have an average of more than 10 cases of TB reported per year. Counties in teal have an average of 5 to 10 cases of TB reported per year. And counties in the light blue have less than 5 cases of TB reported. And you may have noticed very few Washington counties are shaded in gray, which here represents those counties with no reported TB disease cases over the time period. And therefore, TB disease occurs in most areas of Washington and is also more concentrated in the urban areas, as seen with the dark blue color. This slide shows TB case rates by age group and sex at birth. Males are shaded in the blue color and females are shaded in the green color. From 2017 to 2021, higher case rates of TB were experienced by males compared to females. And over the same time period, when stratified by age group and sex as presented here, males age 65 and over experienced the highest case rate compared to all other groups. And there are many risk factors to consider when thinking about TB in Washington. This slide shows the prevalence of 5 common risk factors among Washington TB cases. And when we talk about risk factors for tuberculosis, these can be risk factors for being exposed to and infected with TB, or they can be risk factors for progressing from TB infection to TB disease. Please note that individuals may fall under more than one risk category. And from 2017 to 2021, Washington residents born somewhere other than the US and its territories accounted for approximately 80% of TB cases in Washington. And TB is more prevalent in certain parts of the world other than the US, and therefore risk of exposure to TB is greater for people in those areas. And certain medical conditions can lessen the ability of the immune system to keep TB infection from progressing to TB disease. And diabetes is one example of this. Approximately 23% of TB cases in this five-year period had a diagnosis of diabetes at or before their diagnosis of tuberculosis. And then during the same five-year time period, approximately 7% of TB cases in Washington were a known contact of a person with infectious TB within 2 years prior to their TB diagnosis. And again, this relates to a greater risk of exposure to TB. And 4.5% of cases during this time had experienced homelessness in the year prior to diagnosis. And 2.7% of TB cases in Washington during this time had a history of incomplete LTBI therapy. And without treatment, approximately 5 to 10% of infected persons will go on to develop TB disease at some point in their lifetime. In most cases, tuberculosis is treatable and curable. However, persons with TB can die if they do not get the proper treatment. Among TB cases diagnosed in Washington from 2017 to 2021, slightly less than 7% of patients died before diagnosis or during treatment. And 54% of those deaths were attributed to TB disease or TB treatment. Early and accurate detection of TB is important in reducing TB deaths in Washington. And CDC recently launched their Think, Test, Treat TB campaign to increase testing and treatment for latent TB infection in the US. And more information can be found by following the hyperlink on this slide, which was included in the supplemental materials sent out before this session. And World TB Day is observed each year on March 24th, and the Stop TB Partnership has selected Invest NTB Save Lives as the 2022 theme, which conveys a large funding gap that has slowed progress to combat TB globally. We have made a lot of great progress so far, but there's still a lot of work to be done in eliminating TB. And please feel welcome to contact us at the State TB Program. Our contact information is listed here and is also available on our website, which can be reached by searching for Washington Department of Health TB Program or by navigating to the link shown here. And thank you all for being here today and letting us share this information with you. And again, please keep any questions until the end of all presentations. Thank you.
Thank you, that was a wonderful presentation. So is the preferred format that we don't answer questions now, Lana, or what would you like to hear?
Oh yeah, so we've muted everyone to then allow for unmuting during the Q&A session.
Okay, well, our speakers will stick around to answer your questions at the end.
Yeah, great. Go ahead and start screen sharing when you can, Jocelyn.
Does that look okay?
Yep, got it.
Great, thank you. Okay, so I'm just gonna start by introducing myself. My name is Jocelyn. I use she, they pronouns. As Lana introduced, I am a member of We Are TB, which is a survivor advocacy group, as well as a advocacy member of the Curry Center Western Region. I'm also a first year medical student at the University of Washington. Today I'll be talking about the patient perspective by sharing a personal story about TB diagnosis and treatment. As I said, feel free to share any questions in the chat and we will try to get to them after the presentation is complete. I'd like to start with a land acknowledgement, acknowledging the unceded land of the Coast Salish people, which touches the shared waters of all tribes and bands within the Duwamish, Suquamish, Tulalip, and Muckleshoot regions, which is the land which the University of Washington is where I am currently presenting. I'd like to emphasize that these people are still here today, and it is our responsibility to act in solidarity with these peoples whose land has been unjustly stolen. I'd like to recommend that you also look into which native land you are currently residing on from where you're zooming in as well. I'd also like to acknowledge the labor of enslaved peoples that was also put into creating the institutions that we are currently presenting from today. I do not have any disclosures for this talk. Our objectives today are to describe a patient experience of TB treatment in order to address barriers to treatment completion and improve completion rates. Secondly, we'll discuss a patient's experience of TB diagnosis and treatment to identify strategies to deliver empathic, culturally conscious care. And without further ado, I will go ahead with just telling my personal story about TB diagnosis and treatment. I was a senior in high school leaving a tennis tournament when I got the call. My father was hospitalized at St. Joseph Medical Center in Tacoma, Washington. My mother had noticed for a while that he had trouble climbing the three flights of stairs to our apartment unit, but he had been too stubborn to see a doctor. That day, his shortness of breath was so severe that he finally allowed her to take him to the hospital. "They think he has TB," I heard my mother say over the phone. She sounded confused, understandably, because at that point in our lives, we had no understanding that TB still even existed. They had assumed my father had contracted TB latently while living in the Philippines, and that it was now reactivated in his older age. I would later learn that the Philippines ranks fourth worldwide for tuberculosis incidence. Many other populations are similarly at risk for higher risk for TB because of crowded living conditions, lack of access to clean air, and barriers to receiving healthcare. For the following weeks, as his condition stabilized, I spent my time at the hospital until 10 or 11 p.m. and then worked on homework until I was too tired to stay awake. That year, my father wrote me a check for my prom dress from his hospital bed. Throughout that entire hospitalization, not a single staff member explained to me what TB is or what this diagnosis would mean. I do remember explicitly the case manager telling me not to tell anyone at my school what was happening. She thought my peers might think I could infect them, but she never told me if that was even biologically possible. She took blood from myself and my mother and diagnosed us both with positive QuantiFERON results over the phone. I would begin treatment immediately alongside my mother and father. My father's treatment included what I now know to be the right drugs: rifampin, isoniazid, pyrazinamide, and ethambutol. Four pills on the surface seem simple enough. However, adherence to TB treatment is crucial in ensuring its effectiveness. A caseworker visited every day to watch my father take his pills. When she was unavailable, my mother was tasked with recording videos of him taking his medication. Until my father can complete this regimen consistently for 6 months straight, he would still be at risk of infecting others. Because of this, he was forcibly quarantined at home in our small two-bedroom apartment. This was once a man who never missed a day of work as an electrician for Weyerhaeuser. He was even there maintaining the electrical lines when Ronald Reagan visited Washington State in 1984. Now he woke up in his armchair because he could no longer breathe deeply while lying flat, sat in his chair to watch television, and fell asleep once again in that same chair. Things got better after he finished his treatment, but only slightly. His shortness of breath was so significant that he could only walk a block or two before needing to rest. Even then, he needed supplemental oxygen that he carried in a small tank in a shoulder bag. He drove to all the biggest moments in my life and could only wait in the car until I was done because it was too daunting to even cross the parking lot. So this picture is me. I had won a pageant in undergrad, and it was at the University of Washington, Tacoma. And my mom couldn't, she doesn't really drive on the freeway, so my dad drove, but he just waited in the car because he didn't want to have to go through the extreme effort to like walk to wherever the audience was. So we just took a picture together at home afterwards. And this is a picture of us when he was hospitalized he eventually discharged to rehab. I was smiling there because it's Easter, so we took a family picture. These muted moments of joy were punctuated by unpredictable hospitalizations. Though TB had cleared his body, the disease and even the treatment itself had severely damaged his organs, especially his liver. These visits showed me the true dark side of medicine. During one of these hospitalizations, they had called a Tagalog interpreter because they believed he couldn't speak English, when he was actually exhibiting signs of altered mental status due to a severe ammonium toxicity. This led to a month-long stay in a rehabilitation facility where he had to relearn how to read and write, cared for by overworked and underpaid nursing staff who did not even have the time to clean or change him. This all culminated in his final hospitalization in fall of 2017. I was a junior in college then, leaving the library when I received yet another phone call. This was one of the last times my father and I had a real conversation. He told me, "Always study hard and always go to the hospital, go to the doctor when you're sick." A few days later, he was found to have an intracranial brain hemorrhage and was no longer physically conscious. Up until this moment, my mother demonstrated unmeasurable strength, serving as my father's caregiver on top of her own job and physical health. She bathed him, cleaned up after him, and took him to the hospital when he needed it most. And it was in this moment that yet again, she showed her strength in being able to let him go. When the tubing was disconnected and removed, it was just us and my father. And even though we all work in healthcare in one way or another, no one tells you what it's really like to see someone breathe their last breath. It's haunting and raw and really intimate in a way you can't describe. I held my father's hand until it was seeped of his warmth, and he died. I tell you this story because it's probably one of the only one of many stories of immigrant families who face TB diagnosis and treatment in the United States. And while each patient is truly unique, I hope that there are some common themes from our story that you can one day apply to your treatment of others. I don't think I truly got to know my father until after his diagnosis, and even after his death. In the Philippines, he was a passionate student activist during the time of martial law and put his life on the line to do so. Even in the US, he was hardworking and stubborn and always fought for what he thought was right. He jogged every day, loved road trips, and carefully maintained several aquariums. While we try our best to hold on to what we could after his treatment, some of those most cherished parts of his life were seemingly gone forever. Second, TB was not only isolating from my father, who was bound by the Department of Health to never leave his home, but also to me, who couldn't tell my classmates why I was having such a difficult time in school, or to my mother, who suddenly took on so many more obligations at home. However, I can both hold those challenges in importance and also recognize the privilege that we had to have the material means to physically isolate. TB disproportionately impacts those displaced into communal living or homelessness, and they don't have the same opportunities to truly quarantine during their treatment. Third, TB treatment is not easy. I could have spent this entire half hour reading the side effects and contraindications for each RIPE drug. On top of the challenges I already mentioned with adherence and isolation. It's funny, I remember sitting in my infectious disease class during my fall quarter of medical school, and the instructor had offhandedly mentioned TB during a lecture about antibiotic resistance. But he had said, TB is easy to treat. TB was not mentioned again for the remainder of the infectious disease class aside from a short pharmacology lecture. These treatments save the lives of TB patients, but they can also be damaging in so many ways, and it's important that we recognize that. Finally, tying it back to my tennis tournament that started it all, one of my proudest accomplishments was winning most improved in tennis twice. And I think that might have been a testament to how little skill I had in tennis to begin with. But I mention this because I think TB deserves the award for most room for improvement. We have all now survived and continue to survive an encounter with a deadly infectious disease and its associated quarantine. The rapid response that science and healthcare has exhibited in response to COVID-19 brings me so much hope, but it also comes with frustration and anger. Because I know that if the US response to TB was even fractional to that of their response to COVID-19, I am certain that TB could have had faster detection rates, less invasive treatment, and better outcomes decades ago. I'm certain we could have reached rates of near eradication from the earth. I believe that this disparity exists for two main reasons. One, TB disproportionately affects some of the most disadvantaged in our communities who have the least access to expressing desire for change. And second, there's a lack of public awareness about the severity of TB disease and treatment. As a teenager, I had no idea that TB even still existed. And now, you know, even faculty members at medical school have even minimized the true impacts of TB in their treatments in their teachings to medical students. If nobody knows it's a problem, nothing will be done to solve it. I do my best to help make those realities known by participating in legislative advocacy with We Are TB. As a part of that organization, I tell this story to lawmakers to show them how much it would mean for more funding to go towards TB training, treatment, and prevention. And I sit here today telling my story to you all to further that goal. But what could I do, you might be wondering? Well, I think my father said it best. You already do so much to study hard in your respective healthcare and public health fields, but I hope this talk is a helpful reminder to not only study the pharmacology, epidemiologic implications, and contact tracing principles of TB, but also the lives of each of those little data points. We are more than numbers, and our stories are so important and so educational. Second, I hope you take the time for your own wellness. I do discuss a few negative experiences with our case manager in this story, but I believe strongly that if TB caseworkers, nursing staff, and clinicians were given the time and resources to take care of themselves properly, they would have the capacity to approach these situations with more empathy and care. I'd like to close with presenting a few practical frameworks for improving empathic and culturally conscious care for TB patients. I'd like to start with just quickly describing a framework for promoting culturally conscious care, interrupt. And this can be used to interrupt any microaggressions or acts of racism you may observe or participate in during your care of TB patients. First, it's important to approach these situations with curiosity, especially if you are approaching as a third party, in order to prevent any defensiveness from any of the parties involved to help de-escalate any situations. That kind of goes into N, which is to attempt to appear non-threatening if you're approaching as a third party, also for your own safety and comfort as well. T, take responsibility. If you are yourself are somehow involved in a situation where a patient may feel offended or hurt, it's important that you own up to that in order to maintain trust both with your colleagues and with your patients. E, empower. So when you do approach these situations, try to ask questions about how can we do things differently next time so that these conversations come to people's minds in the future when similar situations may arise. R, reframe. This means that when you are inquiring into situations of hurt and harm, to ask, how can we think about that differently? To help put the power in the hands of those who are participating in the situation to come to their own solutions and their own beliefs that are conducive to promoting the safety of everyone involved. R, redirect. I think this is most helpful in situations where you might feel pressure about your employment status or your reputation, where you can still make a difference in the lives of patients by helping to redirect conversations that maybe have acts of microaggressions or racism so that they can feel more comfortable and at ease and that the topic can be changed to something else. This is helpful if you plan to discuss this topic with your colleague at a later time. You use impact questions. This is very similar to empower in that asking, how would someone feel about what you just said, essentially? And this can really help bring someone's attention to the impact of what they'd said, because in a lot of those situations, the intent was not there. And this helps them realize that even if they had good intentions, there was impact to their words or actions. P, paraphrase, essentially rewording what someone said so that they can see how their words came off. And finally, T, teach by using I phrases, which essentially means when you do encounter situations where a patient could be treated better, to say, I personally feel hurt by what's happening, or I feel concerned about what's happening, rather than coming from an accusatory stance. And then I'd also like to share a framework for more empathic TB care. I do see a few of my school medicine colleagues in the audience, so this will just be a lot of review, but essentially this is a way you can help to get in touch with a patient's feelings. This is especially helpful for situations of high stress and burnout, which is unfortunately all too common in TB healthcare. So you start with naming the emotion. It sounds like you're feeling frustrated about having to quarantine during your treatment. Then you seek to understand what the patient is going through and expressing that understanding. I can see why it would feel hopeless that you're not able to walk to work anymore. Then you try to express your respect for the patient by highlighting some of their strengths that you've observed. It takes so much strength to go through this routine every single day. Then you build partnership with the patient by expressing your support in their journey towards treatment. We will get through these 6 months and beyond together. And finally, Explore what might lead the patient to feel that way. Tell me more about what your treatment has been like for you. And you may be wondering what the importance is of these frameworks, given that my musings about TB treatment has come off as somewhat pessimistic, but I'd like to share a quote from a paper that really inspired me to pursue medicine that talks a lot about patient suffering, and I feel like it applies all too well to TB patients today. By our account, intention, sustained presence, and the act of recognizing and acknowledging the patient's suffering are the ends to be achieved, even if the relief of that suffering is not attained. Nevertheless, at the same time, it is important to admit that sitting with the silence of suffering is hard. It may not always be emotionally sustainable or logistically feasible. Returning to a suffering patient's room day after day often feels supererogatory or above the call of duty. And yet, paradoxically, in our experience, this is the heart of medicine. As Castle would likely affirm, the best medicine requires more than clinical expertise. The best medicine also requires wisdom, empathy, compassion, courage, and humility. Indeed, the calling of the clinician is to return, to sit, to stay, and ultimately, one can hope to heal. Medicine is a moral art. My relationship with my father was far from perfect, but it was ours, and we deserved to have the time to make it better and to make more memories together. It is my hope that by telling this story to you, other daughters and fathers, and all forms of blood-related and found families may make more memories outside of the hospital rooms, across parking lots, and long into all of their lives. I thank you for your time and attention.
I'd like to thank Jocelyn for sharing such a personal story and giving us excellent advice on how to better treat our TB patients. And Jocelyn, you should look at the chat box for a bunch of gratitude for your presentation today. I'd also like to thank Kelsey for presenting on Washington State TB numbers.